Today we are facing some of the greatest challenges of our lives, from our health to political unrest, the environment, financial uncertainty, and the nation's racial divide. Welcome to Bill Myers Inspires. My idea for this show was to invite guests and get the conversation started, to take a deep dive into the issues that impact our world with an eye to exploring solutions. And we encourage our listeners to look within themselves to take decisive action to make a positive difference. Welcome to Bill Myers Inspires. I'm your host, Bill Myers. And today, we have a wonderful show lined up. But today is, there's a lot of things going on today as we celebrate Good Friday, as Christian folk do, leading up to Resurrection Sunday. And so I think it is befitting that my guest today is an individual that I shared the stage with in Godspell. So I wanted to tie that all together. So it's not just random. It makes sense. So today our topic is on anti-Asian hate crimes, which have been on the rise in this nation for quite some time. Now, if you recall back in October, actually October the 16th, I had on the show Christine Toy Johnson, and we were talking about at that time the sort of emergence of Asian hate crimes in America. And certainly since October the 16th, things have increased, one would say, exponentially. So I want to have an opportunity to redress this topic because it is taking the headlines of our news feed today, and it is something very, very important that I think we should get a handle on, as we are here and prone to address issues like racism and all of that nasty stuff. So again, anti-Asian hate crimes, America versus humanity, with my guest today, Mia Korf. Anti-Asian hate crimes are continuing to grow in America. Are these hate crimes the same as racism when perpetrated against Blacks in America? I just think it's very interesting that when we refer to certain groups, we use different language, but I think at the end of the day, we're at the same place. Is America in a battle with its own diversity and its citizens of color? When will America embrace humanity over hatred, division, and oppression? My guest today is an actress, and she's a mama, and she's an entrepreneur, and she's a lots of things. So I'm going to tell you a little bit about her. Mia Korf's escapades as a performer crisscross the country in the worlds of Broadway, Off-Broadway, regional theater, television, film, commercials, voiceovers, and the Los Angeles live music scene. Mia started out in life as a classical violinist. She had her first lesson before her third birthday and was mentored by Hamao Fujiwara, okay, pardon me if I butcher that, of the Julliard School before attending Cornell University. Mia is also a certified mediator and an accredited Suzuki violin teacher. I didn't know that. Mia recently returned to her hometown of Ithaca, New York, to help care for her mom and spend time with her daughter, who is at Cornell in the class of 2023. She has spent the last few months settling into her 1928 Craftsman home and creating jewelry for her Etsy shop entitled ViaMiaDesigns. She's thrilled to reconnect with Bill Myers. Who is that? And contribute to this conversation of inspiration. So before we go much further, I have to introduce my good friend, Mia Korf, but I want to do that in the appropriate fashion. So just hold on a second. We got theme music for Mia.
Uh-oh.
Prepare.
Prepare ye the way of the Lord. Prepare ye the way of the Lord.
Please help me welcome my special guest, Mia Korf. Mia!
Hello, Bill. Thanks for having me on your podcast.
You're the first to have theme music. You do realize that.
I am so honored. Wow. Thank you. Thank you. Good times, huh?
Yeah, absolutely. Absolutely. Well, I thought with Holy Week, and I thought certainly with copyrights, they wouldn't bother me because he's singing a cappella, and it is biblical, you know. So, so welcome to the show today. And I want to, again, sort of back into this topic and sort of get your initial thoughts on where we are with this crazy anti-Asian racism stuff going on in the country. I just want to hear from your heart right now.
Well, thanks. And I'm sure I'm going to repeat some of the stuff you talked about with Christine, who I worked with years ago. I adore her. On the one hand, it's so shocking to me what's going on. On the other hand, I don't think I ever thought I would see people brazenly with Nazi flags. I don't think I ever could have imagined in my wildest dream that we would have to see footage of George Floyd. You know, I mean, so a part of me is absolutely shocked and a part of me is not. But when I look at the things that I think are contributing, it's really sad to me. I mean, on the one hand, obviously we've had leadership, we've had, you know, media figures just spewing absolutely poisonous rhetoric, right? Mm-hmm. And with the pandemic at the forefront of this discourse and leadership calling, naming this virus as the Kung Flu and the China virus, basically giving people permission to let their racist freak flags fly.
Right.
I mean, that's just the start. I think another facet that I come to is the recent movement with Black Lives Matter. Even the most bigoted people kind of know now, oh yeah, it's not cool to, you know, be openly racist against BIPOC people, right?
Right, right.
And in a way, I wonder if just that energy, that hatred, that whatever it is that spurs people on to have that kind of negativity, I wonder if it's now just pivoted conveniently to another group of people to blame for your troubles. And I say convenient also, Bill, because we don't have to reach that far back in history.
Right.
Vietnam, before that, the Korean War, before that, World War II. If you look at the last 80 years, for 40 of those years, yellow man was the enemy, like literally, you're killing, right? At war. So it's this sort of, I hate to use this phrase because it's not perfect, but perfect storm. Mm-hmm. And on top of it, I have to mention this uptick in, and I don't know if you guys covered this with Christine, but the majority of these crimes are happening, almost 70% of them that have been reported, and I'll get back to that in a second because those statistics are to be really looked at.
Right.
Almost 70% are specifically against Asian women. So get into the conversation of intersectionality with racism and sexism, because they can't really be parsed out. Long history of objectifying Asian women, perceiving them as being more docile, or, you know, they become seen as easier targets, perhaps. But also there are a fair amount of women who are working in the sex industry, et cetera. But, you know, that conversation, we could spend a whole podcast on just that.
Right.
Reality. So I'm happy to see that we now have leadership that is addressing this full on. I mean, Biden came out and strongly saying that these are the things that he wants to do. And you know, there's a lot of resources for people now who are wondering, like, what can I do to help, right?
Right.
But as far as my own personal feelings, it's really, like I said, it's so shocking for me to think about, you know, when I grew up in upstate New York, when, you know, we were the only real Asian family around. And of course, I absorbed a certain amount of just, you know, racism that kids, I don't know, I guess you learn it, right? I guess you learn it in the home. But like my sister was saying today, every day she got on the bus, it was, oh, the Chimichang girl. You know, it's every day something. I remember even though when we were working on Godspell together.
Right.
Every time I get on the subway, I subconsciously would feel myself kind of tighten up and sort of like get ready for some kind of comment, right? It was just a part of life. I don't know which way to go right now because there's so many different things, topics I could talk about.
That's interesting because and that's good. I just wanted to kind of let you sort of wonder where you needed to go before we get into some specifics, because that was where I wanted to go next, was to talk about your own heritage, your own experience as a youngster growing up. Uh-huh. I wanted to address and take a look at that. So tell us about that. I mean, you were leading on to some of the comments on the bus and that sort of thing, but, you know, tell us about your family. You grew up in Ithaca as a youngster. So is your family first, second generation in America? I mean, I just kind of want to get a picture of that experience.
My mom was raised in Japan. Okay. But my dad, when he was over there teaching, and then married him at a very young age, and then came to the States and had four kids. Mm-hmm. And in some ways, we had a very typical American upbringing. In other ways, not so much. I mean, my mother's not a very typical Japanese woman. The very fact that she left Japan in her early 20s and ran off with a, you know, tall American guy right there, you know, set her apart a little bit.
Right.
But it wasn't cool growing up being half Asian. There just weren't any others of us around.
Yeah.
So, you know, you always felt other. You were always meant to, and probably didn't help that I ticked a lot of the stereotypical boxes. You know, I was studious, play the violin, had the long stringy hair. You know, I was sort of, I was voted most likely to succeed. You know, hilarious, but it wasn't cool, you know? And it wasn't until I got into acting, into theater late into high school, that a whole other world opened up to me of, oh, people can see me for something other than just that. And they can see that I have this skill set or that skill set. And, you know, it was an important time for me going through that.
There are a lot of very interesting parallels in that, you know, in the mixed race scenario, because very similar scenario for me. I mean, my mom is white, grew up in, you know, she was from Arkansas, you know, very much sort of redneck and sort of background, racist background, family, and my father being black and police officer in Indianapolis. I mean, but growing up, as you say, I mean, we were oftentimes the only mixed kids, biracial kids in an entire school. So you're looking to the left and right, and it's like, I don't really know where I suppose I fit in. And that other box was the box. That was the only option at that particular time. There's an odd duck scenario. And again, music I found early on, as you did, but then it was the theater, I think, was a big turn.
Yeah.
Because you got a chance to express yourself and come out and say things, because I don't think that I could articulate very well early on. So music was my voice box, because right, I didn't really know what the right thing to say or the wrong thing to say was. So, I mean, I just sort of kept to myself. So I totally get that. So there, So we have very much common ground on many of these issues. And I got a feeling we'll discover it more and more as the conversation continues.
Yeah, as I got a little older, I was thinking about you the other day, Bill, because we do have an awful lot of crossover. When I went off to college and then I left and went to New York, you and I tumbled onto the entertainment scene around the same time, late 80s, early 90s.
Right, right.
During a time when this non-traditional casting thing was all anybody could talk about in the casting circles, right?
Right, right.
And we both benefited, and we both had things that we had to straddle. I want to make sure you tell your story about The Wiz.
Oh, yeah, absolutely, yeah. Absolutely.
But it was interesting because on the one hand, oops, I better turn off this. I'm so sorry, I'm getting texted about my family. I had a lot of opportunities I would not normally have had, I think. One of my first really big jobs was Shakespeare in the Park. And I was in New York understudying Barbara Rush, who is about 5 feet tall, blonde. It was hilarious. It's a good thing I never had to go on. None of her clothes or anything would have fit me. I was horrible. But there was a lot of situations like that I found myself in where, this whole idea of not quite colorblind casting, but non-traditional casting.
Right, right.
I mean, who knows even if Godspell would have happened? Who knows? Who can say?
Right.
Who can say?
Right.
And then a few years later, right after Godspell, actually, accepting a contract role on One Life to Live. At that time, there weren't any Asians on daytime, except for a few who spoke with an accent. So I took this as, wow, well, politically speaking, I've got to take this job. I got to represent.
Right.
The irony was, there was no mention. It was so colorblind and it was so non-traditional that there was no mention of my race. I was just Dorian's niece. So in retrospect, what a missed opportunity. It would have been a fantastic time to explore some of those issues. But, traditionally a little more conservative further back,
sure.
We weren't ready to have, I don't think, a fully integrated Asian American character maybe on that show, although we had the first gay character in daytime. It was a very young Ryan Phillippe. That was actually more ahead of the curve than addressing my ethnicity. And to wit, when I left the show, my character, I was replaced by a tall blonde Texan playing the same role. The role of Blair Dane Lewis Buchanan is now played by a tall
blonde. That's so interesting. Well, we're gonna take a break real quick and we'll be back in just a minute. You're listening to Bill Myers Inspires right here on the Inspired Choices Network. And today we are discussing anti-Asian hate crimes with my guest, Mia Korf. We'll be back in just a moment.
Today we are facing some of the greatest challenges of our lives, from our health to political unrest, the environment, financial uncertainty, and the nation's racial divide. Tune in every Friday at 3 p.m. Eastern Standard Time for Bill Myers Inspires as he and his guests take a deep dive into the issues that impact our world with an eye to exploring solutions. Emmy Award-winning actor Bill Myers is an accomplished actor, jazz musician, filmmaker, writer, educator, and speaker. As a biracial man who's both black and white, Bill leverages his background, talent, and voice through creativity, compassion, and connection as activism for social justice to focus on uniting the divide and compelling change. Bill Myers Inspires encourages listeners to look within themselves and take decisive action to make a positive difference. For more information, visit his website, BillMyersInspires.com, and sign in for the latest news and updates.
Are you a subject matter expert? Are you here to share your expertise with an audience waiting to hear from you in only the way you can deliver? Are you ready to have your voice amplified across the airwaves? Inspired Choices Network has a global radio platform streaming to millions of people across the world. Professionally produced and supported by an accomplished team every step of the way, you can broadcast from anywhere in the world, knowing your voice matters, and we ensure it is delivered with ease and efficiency. Eager to hear your message, the world awaits. Contact us today to become an Inspired Choices Network radio host. Email becomeahost@inspiredchoicesnetwork.com.
You're listening to Bill Myers Inspires here on the Inspired Choices Network. We're here every Friday at 3 p.m. Eastern Standard Time. Thank you for joining us. And now, let's get back to the conversation. We're back. You're listening to Bill Myers Inspires, and today we're discussing anti-Asian hate crimes in America, and it's America versus humanity. And with my guest, Mia Korf. Mia, I've got some stuff I want to share with you before we continue this here conversation, and it is this is an article that I pulled up that was written by Kimmy Yam on March 9th, 2021. The headline is Anti-Asian Hate Crimes Increased by Nearly 150% in 2020, mostly in New York and LA, reports say. And so what this is suggesting is, and it further goes on to say, analysis released by the Center for the Study of Hate and Extremism at Cal State University, San Bernardino, this month examined hate crimes in 16 of America's largest cities. It revealed that while such crimes in 2020 decreased overall by 7%, those targeting Asian people rose by nearly 150%.
Yeah.
And I suppose that contributes to the post on Facebook that Christine Toy Johnson put up just a couple of days ago, which says we should not have to be afraid to walk down the street because someone might attack us from behind, push us to the ground and kick us in the head a few times while security guards watch and then close the door. I don't even know what to think anymore.
Yeah. So those statistics are really frightening, sobering.
Yeah.
Especially this, you know, overall hate crimes had gone down 7% because of COVID, because of the pandemic. People are not.
That's exactly it. Exactly.
They're not even out in the world. And yet, for AAPI folks, up 150%. The other thing, I don't know if she's mentioned that later in the article, but only like there's a third of crimes that don't get reported. There's a, I want to say, cultural barrier for reporting for a lot of Asian people. It's not comfortable for them to speak out, or they fear repercussions from the police, where there's language barriers. Also, you know, just the difference in culturally maybe not wanting to make a big fuss. So it's up 149%, 150% that we know of, that we can document.
But yeah,
many undocumented cases that how do we really get purchase on what that number really is?
Yeah, you know, and I want to expand on that because I want to draw some other parallels. Just as you say, you know, the number of cases with regards to Asian, anti-Asian hate crimes are not reported. I would expand on that and show you this whole sort of similarities. People of color, wouldn't that thing would be true of Black people, Latino people, you know, Asian people. Also in that same minority group, let's put women in there as well. So now we're talking about the unreported, unreported rapes, offenses toward women. So similarly, you've got the same level of silence of people who don't want to deal with authorities because they don't necessarily see that as a relief to the issue. In fact, it could invite more problems into their lives. So I find that to be very, very interesting that there is that same parallel. And that's not to by any means dilute the power of what you're saying. It's just, I want to put it in a context. I've been talking about racism since I started this show. And so once I start to see the statistics here, you start going, you know, unless you're a white male, we're all in a boat of second class citizenry in some sort of way. And the white male is still running the show. And you see what I mean? So the threat is still very much present. And I'm glad to see the activities and the fact that we can have conversations like this, which, as you mentioned, you know, back in the late 80s and some of the other times, I don't know, I would probably not be able to say many of these things. And a lot of people wouldn't, quite frankly, because we were in another stage of denial. So you had asked me to speak to my experience in the late 80s, 90s of this non-traditional casting issue. So I was in the thick of that with regards to Actors Equity Association, which is the professional theater actors union. And so I was pretty active in that. And when all of that non-traditional stuff came out, like the first time, let's try this. And as it turned out, the very first case in the nation of the non-traditional casting scenario was a production of The Wiz in Chicago. And the production cast the Dorothy as a white young lady. And that upset lots and lots of people because they were like, oh, they cried foul on this. And I had to stand in that space of saying, wait a minute. It doesn't just apply to Black people, Latino people, Asian, whatever. No. That is across the board. So they have exercised non-traditional casting. They took a Black musical and cast a white girl in the lead role. So, you know, you have to accept that. And that wasn't a very popular thing to say. And I realized that it was, you know, so I was on a whole lot of people's list and probably called a whole lot of names. And I would have been calling myself the same names too, because I understood what it was, but you can't have it one way only. You know, if you're going to go down that path, you really have to look out for the broadest application of that, you know. So, but anyway, be that as it may, so I want to continue to talk about, what do you see in your experience or experience of those that you might know, loved ones or what have you, in recent times? Any encounters or any looks or any strange things? Because this whole being out, the racists are out. I mean, they are out. That the whole Trump thing sort of brought, all of them have surfaced. And oddly enough, some of them were people that, you know, I grew up with and thought we were cool. And I thought, man, if you ever held thoughts like that or spoke them aloud, then there's no way we would ever be friends. So it makes me really question that they were just guarded, but they were racist all along. I don't think you get jumped into that game. I think you are or you aren't.
And that, you know, that starts with education. I don't think anybody's born racist. I don't think anybody's born hating, you
right.
know, what you get fed and what you learn through your family culture, what have you.
Exactly. Exactly.
Well, it's funny you should ask. You know, I'm at the very beginning of the pandemic, living pretty happily in Los Angeles, and Trump made a speech. I want to say it was on March the 11th. And my boyfriend went, oh no. And his spidey senses started tingling. We had a family meeting with myself and him and his daughter, and he just, I don't know, he knew it was gonna happen. And we made a decision that we were gonna escape from LA. Now, it didn't hurt that I had, in what I thought was a very premature move, purchased a home here in Ithaca, in upstate New York, And we weren't planning to come here until August or something. But we decided to just pick up and go. And we were on the road. So 2 days after we left LA, LA shut down. 2 days after we arrived in New York shut down.
And
since then, I feel like I've been in this sort of this bubble here, you know. I haven't been out in the world experiencing personally, you know, people making racist attacks against me. I have friends in New York, a little different. But, you know, the thing about this living here, it's a very woke town. It's a very, you know, we have Cornell University here. We have this history of amazing thinkers from, you know, Ruth Bader Ginsburg to Dr. Anthony Fauci, Toni Morrison, you know.
Right.
Bill Nye, Carl Sagan. We have these, you know, this culture here is very educated and very forward thinking. I have to tell you this, Bill, because you'll find this interesting. Our mayor is a young Black man who joined the city council when he was 20, when he was still in college, and he became mayor at 24. He's half Black. He's formerly homeless. And this man, he's not perfect, okay? But a community that would elect him, and now we are seeing he is being featured in Pod Save America, NPR, GQ. He's coming out with really radical ideas, maybe some of the most radical, taking the most radical steps to reform policing.
Yeah.
To reimagine public safety. So there's a way in which where I, you know, you ask the question, have I experienced it myself recently or my family? Not so much. I'm in the, you know, of course
in
there's
the bubble. Yeah.
Here.
Yeah.
But whenever I turn on the news, whenever I read articles, it's like I'm triggered all over again. There's so much early, you know, childhood and early adulthood experiences I had that it's not hard for me to just imagine, you know, if I was living in New York right now or back in LA, what might be going on?
Yeah, you know, I want to talk about that. We're going to take another break real quick, but I want to peel into that a little deeper here in just a second. You are listening to Bill Myers Inspires, and I'm here with my guest, Mia Korf. She doesn't have her bass with her today, but next time for sure.
Today, we are facing some of the greatest challenges of our lives, from our health to political unrest, the environment, financial uncertainty, and the nation's racial divide. Tune in every Friday at 3 p.m. Eastern Standard Time for Bill Myers Inspires as he and his guests take a deep dive into the issues that impact our world with an eye to exploring solutions. Emmy Award-winning actor Bill Myers is an accomplished actor, jazz musician, filmmaker, writer, educator, and speaker. As a biracial man who's both Black and white, Bill leverages his background, talents, and voice through creativity, compassion, and connection as activism for social justice to focus on uniting the divide and compelling change. Bill Myers Inspires encourages listeners to look within themselves and take decisive action to make a positive difference. For more information, visit his website, BillMyersInspires.com, and sign in for the latest news and updates.
You're listening to Bill Myers Inspires here on the Inspired Choices Network. We're here every Friday at 3 p.m. Eastern Standard Time. Thank you for joining us. And now, let's get back to the conversation. We're back. You're listening to Bill Myers Inspires, and I'm here with my special guest, Miss Mia Korf.
She is special.
She is special. She is special. So I said I was going to bring you on here, and I shared with our castmates on our little messenger thing, and I hope they're here with us. Hey, you guys. That I was going to profess my undying love for you. So I'm professing my undying love for you, Mia. So now that I've done that, I did. I want to You were talking about how your recall, how you have not experienced anything in our recent history because of the COVID and living in Ithaca and in a relatively, I don't want to say safe environment. I don't know what you call it, but certainly not the epicenter of Los Angeles and New York City proper, where this stuff is really, really going down, really, really nasty stuff. But you mentioned that as you look at the news, how it could easily trigger and it's right there again. And the word for that is trauma. The word for that is trauma. And I don't think that seems to be something that I encounter over and over again as I keep inviting these conversations about racism and all these different looks at that. It is the trauma, the social trauma of these experiences. That's why it feels like it's just a glance at it, all of a sudden you're right in it. I mean, boy, you remember because those things are seared into our experience. I know that even just at this time, what's going on here with regards to the George Floyd trial is the worst trauma in the world, because you're looking at this thing over and over again from different camera angles and body camera angles, and you're literally watching a man being killed over and over. I thought Rodney King and seeing him get hit 80 some times with kicks and sticks and whatnot was bad. This is truly awful. I was helping a friend put in a floor, a vinyl floor or something, and it was on in the other room. And just to hear all of the gasping for air and the "I can't breathe" and "please, sir," and, you know, and reaching out for your mama and all of that, it is just like the worst.
Yeah.
I don't know.
Where does the hatred come from? You know, where do I be reminded of a?
That's a big question.
Experience that I had while we were doing Godspell. Talk about something that seared into my memory. I was on the subway, and I had a long ride. I was on the A train. I was living up in the near the Cloisters at the time, so that A train would take forever. But a guy came on the subway car. Might have been homeless, might have been a vet, looked very bedraggled.
Mm-hmm.
He was staring at me, and I was very, very, very uncomfortable. At some point, he just started unloading a litany of Asian hate. Just every horrible thing you can imagine, just like came out like vomit. It was, and everybody in the car was staring at me, and I was frozen. I'm sure my face just turned bright red. There was no place to go.
Mm-hmm.
And then the train stopped. And then as if a light switch went off, he looked down, he looked back up at me, and he looked like he was going to start crying. He said, sorry, I'm torn up every time I think about this. He looked at me and he just said, "I'm so sorry." And in that moment, I understood we all have trauma, right? Who knows what trauma he had?
Right.
And, it's important. You know, love thy neighbor, forgive thy neighbor. It's hard to walk that walk sometimes, you know, when someone's coming at you with that kind of stuff. But where does it come from? What happened to that person to make them like that? To look at me and unleash his hate like that? So, you know, I don't know what the answer is. It is so triggering, like you said, reliving those moments. And I don't know. I mean, what do you think, Bill? What do you think is the answer to getting relief is and encouraging people to just let go of whatever false narrative they have against a person's color, what they look like? What does that have to anything to do? It just baffles me.
Well, I think I don't know. I think that they're an attachment to, that it's attached to ego in a lot of ways. It's attached to insecurity more than anything else. Because when you're insecure, you can very easily feel threatened by another. Not because they pose a threat, but just because you're that insecure that you view anything outside of yourself and that which looks like me, thinks like me, lives on the block with me, goes to the school with me, whatever that is, anything outside of that, we're afraid of. And that fear thing, we got fight or flight, you know what I mean? We've got these choices. And I think that fight business and our ability to sort of go over the top and assert ourselves, bully, intimidate, becomes a viable option. And it's really unfortunate because all of these things are in direct contrast to love thy neighbor and to be able to look at one another and introduce yourself as a brother or sister, kindred spirits, where there's only one race. This is at the end of the day, we can talk, have conversations on racism. We're talking about colors and cultures and tribes. That's all we're talking about. Yes. Because there's only one race, and that's a human race. And I really wish that we could get back to that. That's why in the topic of, in the title of the show, I put America versus humanity. Because at the end of the day, if America or America's mindset or that colonialism thing, that dominance thing, which is driven by a need, right? A need to assert and a need to lord over and intimidate. Again, the bully, the braggadocious, whatever. Because clearly, I don't think that there's any question scientifically, archaeologically, or anything else, that people of color have been the dominant on the planet Earth since the beginning of time. It was not, and maybe just that fact alone is I'm outnumbered, I'm outgunned, so we must come up with a scheme or a strategy by which to intimidate and start pushing and oppressing other people that don't look like us. And we must create narratives that make us the hero in everything. It's always bothered me, being an American, the rhetoric of America, that we're the greatest, we're the biggest, we're the baddest, you know, civilization in the history of the world. And it's like, how can you say that when you're about, you know, less than 250 years old? And you're looking at cultures like, whether it be Japan, China, India, you're looking at Africa, you're looking at cultures of thousands of years, and you stand in front of these. I don't have to be the baddest, you know what I mean? But at some point, if I'm number one, that automatically implies that you're number two, three, four, or something less than that. And that has always bothered me because I don't feel that. It makes no sense other than we have the bigger bomb or something. I mean, you know, that level of an intimidation. But outside of that, it's not true. It's just not true. We're the babies on the block as far as nations go. We really are a young nation. And so it's never made a lot of sense to me that we always posture as, we're the superhero, you know. Where does that come from? I mean, I don't feel that way. I'm eager to learn about other cultures and other people and eat what somebody else eats and, you know, sleep where they sleep. I don't want to be in the tourist area. I want to go home with you, man. I want to check out how life is, you know, how you're living, not how McDonald's is, I go across the, you know, globe just to go to McDonald's. It's like, shit, what a waste. I mean, you know what I mean? What a wasted opportunity to get to know my neighbor. What a wasted opportunity to be able to break bread together. I don't know.
Well, I wish everybody had that attitude. I mean, that would be amazing.
Yeah. I just think that, but when you ask what that cause is, I think it's something small within us that that yearns to be, that is something that is threatened. I really do believe that, because what I don't know, I don't care to know. And it's like, well, boy, but if we would just take that next step and seek to know, you know, I always loved that Abraham Lincoln quote about, you know, well, this guy's, you know, I really dislike this guy, and but I need to get to know him better. So that's not running away from the thing I don't like. That's leaning into it and saying, right, well, I need to understand more about me, about what that's all about, and find something likable. You know, when we're playing characters, we can't play characters we don't like. We've got to be in love with them, even though they're rapists, they're killers, whatever their little nasty world is. We got to love on that. And I think there's a lot of truth to that, that we have to find something, yeah, you know, that we can hold on to. So, well, it's time for another break, and this is awesome. And you just flipped this around. So this will be, this is the Mia show. 'Cause you just put me out there and said, why is that, Bill? I'm like, I don't know.
Well, listen, I know you have a lot to say, and I really enjoy hearing you talk. So that was important to me.
No, I'm not busting you. I loved it, actually. It was like, okay, I got this.
Go, Bill.
Well, we're going to step out for a break real quick. You're listening to Bill Myers Inspires, and I'm here with my special guest, Mia Korf, and we're discussing Asian hate crimes in America, America versus humanity. And we'll be right back in just a moment.
Today, we are facing some of the greatest challenges of our lives, from our health to political unrest, the environment, financial uncertainty, and the nation's racial divide. Tune in every Friday at 3 p.m. Eastern Standard Time for Bill Myers Inspires, as he and his guests take a deep dive into the issues that impact our world with an eye to exploring solutions. Emmy Award-winning actor Bill Myers is an accomplished actor, jazz musician, filmmaker, writer, educator, and speaker. As a biracial man who's both black and white, Bill leverages his background, talent, and voice through creativity, compassion, and connection as activism for social justice to focus on uniting the divide and compelling change. Bill Myers Inspires encourages listeners to look within themselves and take decisive action to make a positive difference. For more information, visit his website, BillMyersInspires.com, and sign in for the latest news and updates.
You're listening to Bill Myers Inspires here on the Inspired Choices Network. We're here every Friday at 3 p.m. Eastern Standard Time. Thank you for joining us. And now, let's get back to the conversation. You're listening to Bill Myers Inspires. I'm your host, Bill Myers, with my special guest, Mia Korf. Okay, Mia, I got something for you.
Bring it.
It's just my curiosity, my big time curiosity. And it is, are you ready for this? It is. What was your favorite line in Godspell?
Oh my goodness. Oh, Bill, I don't know. How do you choose a favorite? I have no idea. I have to get back to you on that one.
And that's okay. That's okay.
Line? Do you have a favorite line?
I do.
What was it?
It would wake me up in the middle of the, you know, sort of the rinse and repeat process. Sometimes, you know, you're sitting there thinking about, oh, when am I going to get my laundry done this week? You know, all the stuff that's going on mentally sometimes while you're in the midst of a scene or a performance or whatever. But there was one line that just grabbed me every night, and just was that grab you by the collar or wake you up and I'm back, I'm here, because it just was so very, very powerful. And the line was, "For as long as you are green, brother, you will grow." And I asked about that line because I was doing some little biblical research and looking all over the place. And I could not find it. And so I reached out to Don Scardino, our director, and I sent him a note and I said, Don, where did that come from? And he mentioned that somebody, I don't know if it was a cast member or something, but somebody added that in and it stuck. And wow. That was the favorite line of that entire show, because I could not find it because I wanted to really, and Don said, no, somebody added that in and it stuck. It just made its way into the text as a keeper. But that one line, for as long as you, because it's something about that, even in the question that you posed just a moment ago, you know, I'm not afraid to say I don't know, because that's kind of a good thing. But I don't ever want to be so full of myself that I don't have an opportunity to grow, that I would rather back up sometimes, even when I think I know, to not position myself to know too much, to back up and allow someone space, because there's something for me to learn in that I did not know.
You're still green, brother.
Yeah. For as long as you're green, because you think about the other, and to know it all is to be ripe, and to be ripe is to be dead. Things that are ripe are dead.
Yeah.
A lot of stuff to think about there. But that was the line.
That was the line. Wow, that's great. Wow.
Like a lightning bolt, you know, boom, you know, there it is. And I'm back and I'm here and I'm having a conversation with Jesus, the clown, and all that. But that was a wonderful experience. I still have my Lao Tzu book that Don Scardino gave me, because I wasn't there when you guys started, because you mentioned being the understudy at the New York Shakespeare Festival, and I was the understudy originally for Godspell. And I still remember that day that I was called to actually come in and do the show, and that was terrifying because I'd been under contract for a week, but I had not really been there, but maybe once or twice, because I was shooting a film at the time with Trini called American Blue Note. And so, you know, it was, I think Amanda or somebody said, hey, but you've been under contract for a week, so officially you got to come in. Yeah.
That was terrifying. A week. You went on after a week.
I was like, I think Bill rolled. Jeff was sick, and I think Bill rolled and did Jesus, and then I stepped into Bill Damaschke and did all good things, and that was a song I auditioned with, so I was familiar with that one.
Well, that show would be like doing a 2-hour aerobic session every show. I mean, it was so athletic; we never stopped.
Yeah, it was nonstop. So I think so now I've got about 30 seconds or so. I want to give it to you right now. So, in the midst of this idea of all this anti-Asian activity going on, what would be your thought that you would like to leave with? What is your statement you would like to leave with? And you got about 30 seconds.
Okay. First of all, I really wish I had time to go back and sort of talk about, I had said earlier that it was convenient to pivot the hate towards Asian people. I think what I also meant was that it was familiar, because we don't have to reach that far back, right, to when a time when, you know, you're just hating on Asian people a lot. But the thing I think I'd really like to end with, not dissimilarly, I think a lot of people will wonder, what can I do to help? What can I do to be proactive with the Black Lives Matter? It's not dissimilar. I mean, I think that people can donate their time or their energy. You know, there's tons of sites online where you can do that. I think it's really important to speak up. And then maybe even take the next step, if you're comfortable, to reporting when you see anti-Asian hate crimes. That is part of being an ally, is, you know, basically stepping in front of, you know, if you see something happening, don't just listen to it. Say something, you know.
Say something, do something, show up, be present. Yeah. Absolutely. Yeah. Mia, this has been fantastic, my dear. I've got to get out of here, but, you know, we'll be back. We'll be back again. You're listening to Bill Myers Inspires. Have a wonderful weekend. Thank you so much. Thank you for spending your afternoon right here with us at Bill Myers Inspires. Remember, we're here every Friday at 3 p.m. Eastern Standard Time on the Inspired Choices Network. Remember to take time this week to take a breath and look within yourself and figure out how you can make a positive difference in this world. Spread the word, and we'll see you here next Friday. Have a wonderful week.